Okay, we will call the Public Works Committee to order for August 2nd, 2017 with roll call.
Mr. Katura?
Here.
Mr. McGill?
Here.
Mr. Pelunas?
Here. We have no changes to the agenda. We have three sets of minutes. We can do all of these at the same time. However, the June 7th, 2017 is revised to show at the beginning that Mr. McGill was present at the meeting and did vote on all items, and we did not have that in the minutes, so... We have three sets of minutes. Is there a motion?
I move that we approve the minutes for June 7th, revised, July 5th, and July 13th.
Second.
Second, thank you. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Here.
Mr. Pelunas?
Yes.
Yes. Okay, on our new agenda, number one, storm response status update. Mr. Gilardi, good evening. How are you, sir?
Good evening. How's the committee tonight?
Good.
Have we not been able to afford a name tag for you?
Well, most people just know me, but that would be nice too. But
if we could have the clerk call the clerk of council and ask her for Mr. Gilardi to have a name tag with what's your official title?
I am the sewer division manager for the city of Solon.
Sewer division manager. Maybe we can take Mr. Dursick's old one and...
Sure. Throw some duct tape on that thing.
We'll tape it.
Yeah.
All right.
I'm good with that. It's all about, you know, recycling and stuff. So
we appreciate your generosity in that regard.
I'm just trying to help. Patty, how are you?
I'm good. Thank
okay.
you.
Okay.
All right. Here we go.
Okay, go ahead.
I'd like to give you the report for the drainage division for July. During the month of July, the Service Department Drainage Division responded to flood control on 91 North, 91 South, 43 East and West, hot spots, and all city-owned detention ponds. We went through those and checked them during those couple rainy days we had earlier this month. For the month of July, there was 4.15 inches of rain. Last month, there was 6.04 inches of rain. Okay, for sewer calls for the month of July, the service department responded 9 times to sewer calls, and all 9 were residential issues. For our sanitary PM cleaning for the completed 14 locations citywide were jetted and vacuumed around the city. We completed the sanitary PM cleaning of Cruzy Drive. We started Briar Hill, and we completed Tracy Lane, Woodsmore, Springside, and Timothy Circle. Upcoming for our sanitary PM cleaning would be Briar Hill, Springside, and Ledge Hill. Our storm PM cleaning, we completed Station Street, Mulberry, and Airco. Upcoming, we started Inwood today, so we're working on Inwood. The service department assisted the wastewater treatment plant. We completed 7 of their work orders, and what that is we clean their lift stations for them, and there's some general cleaning that we do with some tees and some sanitary tees that we have to jet and just keep an eye on. Our TV crew responded to 30 locations citywide for TV work. They completed the July PM lateral list, and there were 17 of those. What that is, what a PM lateral list is, it's just something that we keep an eye on, we monitor it, we check it out every month, and that's throughout the year. We have a PM list for each month of the year. We still are in Chagrin Highlands, and we're still on Penfield. Upcoming locations for the TV truck, we just started the August PM list. There are 16 locations. We completed upcoming is Cruzy Drive, Franklin, and Baldwin. For our basement replacement program, we completed the basins on Windy Hill, and we are starting on Dorset. You should have received an email from me, for I emailed all the council people that we are, you know, starting on Dorset Lane. Our excavation crew completed 5 excavations for the month. One on Charnwood Oval, one on Davis Industrial, one on Timber Lane, one on Woodsdale, and we did some work at the Grantwood Golf Club. Our sinkhole crew filled approximately 8 sinkholes this month. And what we do with the sinkholes is we fill them to grade. We dye test them, so we'll use our camera truck, and then we fill them to grade, and then we try to landscape them. And if it's a recurring thing, that'll get added to our grout list. This month, the service department also did 3 confined spaces, one in Hollywood Circle, one in Seneca, and one on Aurora Road. Our storm contractor, Trax Construction, did work on Solon Boulevard, Cannon Road, Arbordale. Arbordale is upcoming, Cannon Road is upcoming. We completed Solon Boulevard today, Station Street, Aurora Road, and Neyman Parkway. Those are upcoming jobs with Trax. My memo for the Public Works Committee, my Public Works Committee memo for the 2017 Sanitary Storm System Repair Program. Below is the summary. I'll use the camera. Everyone see that okay? So the original contract amount was $400,000. Invoice through May was $82,944.32. The retainage was $9,216.04. Tracks did a repair at Patterson Lane. It was an emergency. We have not been invoiced for that yet, but we estimated about $7,000. If you skip down to the next thing, Arbordale, that's going to be a sanitary cleanout replacement. That's a bad sanitary tee. It's approximately 10 feet down. That's $14,319.34. Station Street, which is a basement replacement, there's a basin on Station Street that's collapsing, $16,701.43. Estimated balance, $269,818.87. So like I said, we finished Solon Boulevard today. That was an emergency repair we had to do. I would like to say that with tracks, things are going very well. We're using HR Gray as our inspectors, and they are doing a phenomenal job.
Okay, does anyone have any questions for Mike?
No, nice job, Mike.
Thank you.
Mike, I do have one question for you.
Yes.
First of all, Mike covered most of item number 10, which is the memo for the annual. So we can ask you questions if we have it that time at the end of towards the end of the meeting. Because you covered that real well right now.
Okay.
Question I have for you is, where are we at on the list? I know you sent out, or Bill sent out before you took the position, letters to the homeowners associations for maintenance of the different detention basins that they had to go ahead. Where are we at on that?
Currently, we're going through all the information. Everything has been inspected. City-owned, HOA, private, it's all been inspected. We're currently going over the information, putting the pictures together, and the letters will go out this month.
Okay, would you send us copies of the ones from each of our wards?
Absolutely.
Just so we know what's going on in case we get a call from the homeowners associations or something like that.
Yep, no problem, we'll get that. My goal is to get them out this month.
Okay, just so we know what's going on, the status of those.
Yeah, I'll take care of that.
Okay, no problem. Thank you.
Thank you.
Moving on to item number 2, we have the City of Solon Infrastructure Improvement Report. Good evening, Mr. Bush. How are you?
Good evening. How's the committee tonight?
Good.
To update the committee from last month regarding the infrastructure report, in our Priority 1 projects, we awarded the Roxbury Storm Sewer Replacement Project. Moving down into our Priority 2 projects, we had expenditures in our concrete repair program, our street striping, and as well as our sanitary and storm system repair projects. And moving down into our priority threes, we had updates to our design services as well as our engineering chargebacks and materials testing and our traffic repair. So if there's any questions regarding the update, I can answer those now.
Any questions? Okay, seeing none, we'll move on to item number 3. We have the Bainbridge Road Culvert C-004 Contract 2015.28 for General Engineering Services, and what the Engineering Department is looking for, legislation authorizing the Mayor and the Engineering Department proceed with the load analysis in a not-to-exceed amount of $10,600 under emergency for the reason that the construction is going to be starting and all paperwork needs to be completed. John?
In the email that I had attached, the county engineer's office had asked the city for a load rating analysis, which they had, I guess, thought that I don't know if their contractors that they hire perform that as part of their work, but I know that it was not part of our contractor's work. So I had asked our designer to provide a quote for that, which the committee has before you, which the fee for the load analysis itself is $5,600. And I also have requested of the committee tonight an additional $5,000 to use if in the event that there's any construction structural issues that where we would need to maybe have addressed by Burgess and Ipel during the construction. If we don't use that $5,000, that would ultimately be retained back to the city of Solon. So all in all, I'm asking for an amendment to their current contract in the amount of $10,600 to address the load analysis and to have them on board during the construction.
Any questions for John?
It's pretty thorough, I think.
Is there a motion?
Sure, I'd like to make a, in response to Engineer Bush's July 26, 2017 memo to the Public Works Committee regarding Bainbridge Road Culvert C004, contract number 2015.28, I'd like to make a motion to prepare legislation that authorizes the mayor and the engineering department to proceed with the load analysis and as needed services during construction for the Bainbridge Road Culvert C004 in the not to exceed amount of $10,600. And this legislation needs to be under emergency since the construction will be starting.
Second.
Thank you. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes. Moving on to item number four, the 2017 Annual Asphalt Repair Program, 2017.08. We have a bid tabulation, and they're looking for the program to be awarded to Roniak. Is that correct?
It's pronounced Roniak.
Roniak.
Yes.
Thank you. Paving is the lowest and best bidder on emergency so that we can fix the current infrastructure issues that may cause potential damage to city property. John?
Yes, last Friday we opened bids for our 2017 asphalt annual, and six bids were opened, the results of which are provided here in my memo. The apparent low bidder is Roniak Paving. Their base bid amount was $826,685. We also advertised for four alternates, those being Patterson, the Grantwood Golf Course, Glen Allen, and Russell Drive, which we discussed last month's meeting, or at the special meeting rather. And with those included alternates, their apparent low bid was $1,329,683. We did check references for Roniak Paving, which I've provided in the memo. Roniak Paving is also the contractor that's doing the Richmond Road resurfacing for us in the Village of Oakwood. And everything on that project is going well so far. We provided the bid tab, which is attached, and it's been checked by the Finance Committee. If the committee wants to go over any of the locations, I have brought this map to show the locations. The Patterson location is here in the Thornbury subdivision, or Dorset rather, as well as Patterson. The Solon Boulevard project is right here, as well as this southern piece of Glen Allen. The Russell Drive is obviously down here on the south end of town. We're doing a small repair over at the service department, and I believe that and Grantwood, which is right here, we're doing some repairs to the front entrance area. All in all, like I said, we checked their references, and so I'm recommending that this year's contract be awarded to Roniak Paving in the amount of $1,329,683 under emergency so that we can address current infrastructure issues that may cause damage to our city property as well as our other city infrastructure.
We haven't worked with them before?
Not Roniak specifically. We've worked with the employees of Roniak under other companies, but not Roniak specifically, no.
Does this mean this is a new company?
No, they are not a new company.
Oh.
But one of the main guys there at Roniak Paving, he used to work at another paving company, so I've worked with him at a different paving company.
So you have comfort based upon that prior
yes.
experience?
Yes, plus okay. all of their references were very good. Dan and I also sat through the pre-construction meeting for the Richmond Road resurfacing project with the Village of Oakwood, and that all went very well. So I feel very comfortable in making this award. And it'll be nice to be working with a different contractor than we have worked with in the recent past.
Oh, okay.
Mark, any questions?
I was happy to see that we had six bidders on this project. One of the things that is nice to see when you're reviewing references is, I believe the city of Shaker Heights indicated that this particular contractor had very good communication and good interactions with the residents. And I think that's something that's always really nice to see. So, my one question is, the number six bidder obviously was extremely high. Was there any communication? They were high on their base bid, but even on the alternate, was there any communication as to
what
happened there, if there was an actual mistake? Or
I think it was a mistake in their bid. Patty and I looked at that just based on the language that we have in our bid as far as how we make corrections. Their numbers that they provided in Penn were, for sure, or undeniable. I mean, there was no error, or you couldn't interpret it one way or the other. Obviously, since they were, even without the corrections, they were the number six bidder. So I didn't really dwell on it all that much.
I guess $112 million?
Yeah, and that's based on the corrections, because our language in the bid says that we take the individual unit costs for the labor and material and multiply it by the unit cost. So if there is an error, we use the individual material and unit, or material and labor cost. So there was an error in their bid. But like I said, since they were weren't really in the running as far as the bids were concerned, we didn't really dwell on it all that much. But they have asked for some information as to our correction process and so on and so forth, just so they have it for future reference.
Okay.
I have no further questions.
Yeah, I understand completely. I haven't looked at the chart. I see where they made the error.
That's a pretty significant one.
But it still wouldn't have been. It's still their base bid. Their base bid was still 2.6 million, and it was still more than double the number five. And then the option one, just for people watching, was 112 million versus 107,000 for the, basically 96,000. So I see where the error is. But John, I just have a quick question.
Sure.
With the alternate number two for Grantwood.
Yes.
Is that going to be cart paths, or is it actual sidewalks to the building?
It's going to be actually sidewalks to the building, as well as if anyone's familiar with the front area of Grantwood, it's kind of a horseshoe that ties into the main parking area. Yeah. There's some grade issues that we're going to correct with the actual asphalt circle, as well as remove and replace all of the concrete in front of the building. If anyone's been over there, you know that it's fallen apart and seen its better days. I think Don, as part of this, wanted to do some changes to how the landscape and how the layout is done there. So I think we're actually, when this is all said and done, I think based on the plan that we have that Grant would want to do there, we're actually widening the asphalt entrance. So actually cars, there will be room enough to have a car temporarily parked in front and still allow another car to go by.
Okay,
thank you.
Sure.
Any other questions from the committee?
No, another place for you to play parking lot putt-putt.
That's right. That's about all I can do.
Okay. No, we're good. Mark, you have anything?
No, I have no further questions.
Okay, is there a motion?
I do. I would like to request legislation be prepared that under contract 2017.08, the 2017 annual asphalt repair program be awarded to Roniak Paving in the amount of $1,329,683, and this legislation would be under emergency due to the time of the season and the need to get going.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mr. Paloonis?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, John.
Thanks, John.
We're going to move on to item number five, sanitary sewer connection fee update. Before we start this, I'd like to caution everyone, this is not for residential sewer rates. Anything else? Correct, Paul?
Correct.
Residential sewer rates are the same?
Correct.
Okay. They're not going to be increased by this ordinance, correct?
No.
Okay, just so we have that. So sometimes, anytime you talk about fee increases or fee updates, I just want to make sure everyone understands we're not talking about residential sewer rates.
Correct.
Okay. Paul, go ahead.
Yes. Hopefully, you know, I'm trying to figure out a way to explain this in layman's terms so everyone can kind of understand. It was very complex. The mayor had asked me to look into these rates. Over the course of the past few years, we've had problems with new businesses trying to come in and occupy existing buildings, and it's created quite a challenge for the engineering and planning department, building department, to figure out what their charges would be. Excuse me. So the mayor asked me to look at these and see if, you know, first of all, how they were derived and what they were for, and then also determine, you know, whether anything could be done to change them and make this a little easier. And so I guess to start from the beginning, where these charges came from, they were developed when we did our project back in 1993. It was our expansion of our wastewater treatment plant. And at that time, they added about 1.7 million gallons of capacity onto the existing plant. So since it was an OWDA loan, we had proof to the OWDA that we had a system in place to collect the revenue needed to pay off the loan. So a study was done in 1992. They calculated what the cost benefit would be per that 1.7 million gallons and calculated out per gallon, and it came up with that $7.18 per gallon. So that's where that number came from. And then from that point, there was a guideline that was used by in the Ohio Revised Code of what you charge for specific uses. So you have health clubs, you have hospitals, you have residential homes, apartment complexes. And off that guideline, you took that $7.18 times what you typically saw from those typical businesses or establishments for flow. So just to pull out something, for instance, the health club, and I think the way it was spelled out in our exhibit was, if you look at Exhibit A, that was a copy of the existing one. Private clubs, they calculated $362.50 per member. Okay, that was based on 50 gallons per member at those establishments. That's where they derived that number. They took that, it doesn't come out exactly, but they took that $7.18 times the 50 gallons and came up with the number and said, okay, $362.50 is what the charges are gonna be. Make sense so far? Kind of following me? So, you know, being it based on the loan, there's really nothing that says we have to keep those rates in place. I mean, it was really just there for the OWDA loan. So we're able to go back and look at these. And the problem being is when we really started looking into this and started looking at flow numbers, and I started going, okay, if you look at a health club member, are they really using 50 gallons per day when you sat there and assessed it? And it doesn't make sense. So what we did is we went in and evaluated based on real flow numbers, tried to take numbers that really made flow sense, so to speak, for what we would see at the wastewater treatment plant, and then applied those numbers and actually took them out and took them to the engineering department and let Matt Hartzell calculate them out and see whether they, you know, would match up and seem like a real world situation to us. When we did those numbers and calculations from the new stuff that we have installed here that we're proposing, a lot of these numbers seem to fit realistically. So if you look at Exhibit B, these are some of the, and one of the other problems I wanted to point out is that if you look at Exhibit A, a lot of these application types and explanations of establishments was very vague, and it didn't really align with what planning department had for their applications. So engineering department, planning department, you know, as I mentioned, Matt Hartzell from engineering, we all sat down, we met for virtually 8 months pretty regularly trying to come up with, first of all, applications that matched planning department. So a lot of these new categories that you see listed in green on Exhibit B were categories that we added from the original, which made it easier for, you know, when a new business comes in town to actually give them a something to base our calculations off of. You know, I mean, a lot of times, like beauty salons and spas and barbershops weren't even in the original application. So it made it very difficult, as I was saying, for a new business to come in and for them to calculate what the rates were. So the areas that we highlighted in green, we added to this rate structure and our applications to align with the planning department. In yellow, for these new businesses are the proposed charges that we came up with. Again, going back to how do we come up with these rates, we based them off of real-world flows that we have here. We actually have flow meters. I based them off of water readings that we use for nail salons, barbershops.
Outbound meters.
Outbound meters, correct. Okay. So we actually looked at real flow rates, and I sat back and looked at them and said, those numbers match a lot closer than, you know, these general numbers that were put in there from the get-go. Again, I think we've went over these numbers back and forth between engineering and the planning department, and we're all very comfortable with these new rates that we established.
Paul, the question I have is, I understand how you came up with the, I understand how the research and everything you did on these numbers. The only concern I have is on, like, on the car washing facilities and a couple other things. Some of these numbers might appear to be, if someone wants to open a business in Solon, like a, say they want to open a car wash, or say someone wants to expand their business to, if they have a fuel station or something, put a car wash in, would a number like that just kind of discourage someone from wanting to expand their business? Or, I mean, like when we had the Ultimate Wash, when they expand, when they redid their business and expanded it to for the self-serve capacities, if we had this, would that business owner want to expand, or would they just choose to not make that type of investment because of the sewer tie-in charges?
Well, I think the you know, the problem that you're explaining is exactly the problem we were having, but that was more or less with places like yoga, you know, little yoga establishments that wanted to come in, nail salons, things like that, that were very small, had very limited amount of water that they were using, and getting charged uses that were similar to what a car wash had. And if you think about it, the whole charges are based on water usage. So a car wash is going to have a lot more water usage. And those, when I went back and looked at this amount of usage that you would get from one of these flows and did my research on it, the flow numbers matched the typical research numbers. You know, how many gallons they use per day, and then you apply our $7.18 per gallon flow, that's where it comes out to. So this aligns with the more water you're using, the higher charge you're gonna have. The less water you're using, the less charge you're gonna have. And John, I don't know if you wanna chime in on this, but we looked at, again, when you look at a lot of the smaller businesses and those change in uses, this should help out significantly for those businesses.
Yeah,
it will reduce.
I understand that. I'm just a little concerned sometimes when I see some of the numbers, and you have a new fee versus the current charge, and I understand what the current charge is going to be. Current charge is probably is a lot higher in some sort. I got you, John. Current charge is a lot higher on some of these, but I'm just concerned that if you have a company looking to come in, that they're going to even see the proposed charges and say, well, I don't know if we want to do this. What do other cities currently charge on this is a question for, you know, comparables.
And, you know, I did rate studies for other cities, and it's all over the board. You know, it depends on how much their project costs, how many, you know, what their cost benefit was per gallon. There's nothing really standard out there.
Some cities still have debt on their water reclamation
facility. I'm sure they do. Yes, I'm sure they do.
Because I know when we did the studies in the past, I think it was Twinsburg had like real, real super low rates on some on their sewers for businesses.
but they were subsidizing the plant, and they were doing some other things that, you know, didn't make it a fair comparison. That's why I'm asking.
Mm-hmm.
John?
Just some things I want to add is, you know, in Exhibit A, in Paul's packet, I mean, you know, he talked about the age of this. So, you know, these rates are, and these categories are really antiquated, and we were running into a lot of problems with newer style zoning and trying to apply these old categories. So that was pretty much the basis of the whole restructuring. We had met with Paul and myself and Matt Hartzell from my office, as well as Rob Franklin from the planning department. And a lot of the, and so what we did was in Exhibit A, we took all of the approved zoning classifications that Rob had created as far as uses in all the different zones. And so now we all felt comfortable that we have all of the current zoning classifications covered. So you can look at how much more expansive the proposed schedule is versus the old one. You know, a couple examples, like a few years ago when the outdoor seating for restaurants was very popular, and we wouldn't have a rate to allow somebody to add a seasonal seating for an outdoor patio. All we had was three indoor categories for, you know, a sit down or a semi fast food or a fast food. So now we have another category for that type of thing. And some of these newer style facilities, like a dance studio or so on and so forth. So all of the current rates that we have are now up to speed with current zoning and kind of the newer uses that we're seeing. And like Paul said, we ran them through some kind of real life scenarios as far as fees are concerned, and they seem to be, in all cases, seem to be a lot lower than what we would have charged under the old rates. So I think in the case of when you talk about a business or, you know, somebody wanting to come to Solon and looking at those rates, I think what we're proposing is going to be a lot fairer and a lot more enticing for someone to come in and you know, establish a business here in Solon.
Well, it would be clear.
Yep.
And the other thing I'll add too is, you know, every time that somebody, you know, moves out of a building and somebody moves in, we're not recharging them the whole new rate. Whatever we have on record or we can calculate as far as previous use or previous payment, they're getting credit for that. So a lot of times there may be a credit due or a small increase.
Well, I understand, John, and I think this does make it a lot clearer for businesses that want to come here.
Yeah.
The only thing Paul, you think you did a great job on presenting this and putting this together in the form that you did. The only thing I would just wanted to know is the only concern I have is how businesses will react to this when they want. I understand it's less than what, in a lot of cases, it's less because it's very designated based on the zoning classification and based on the type of building. Mm. But I wanted to make sure that my concern is that if a business A is choosing to build in Solon, and they have a spot in Solon and they have a spot in another city, Solon has this chart and these rates, and you have the same cost of construction, say if they're going to be here or if they're going to be one city over. And is this competitive with what other cities have, or is it going to be a business saying, well, we'd want to locate elsewhere because we're going to be paying a lot more in sewer charges at the initial onset with the tap-in?
I think, honestly, from our current setup that we had, we lost a lot of businesses because of what we had in place.
Because
of the current structure. So this is a huge improvement. Huge.
How will this be communicated to the businesses, and will they be given like a comparative analysis says, under the current structure this is what you're paying, and under the new structure this is what you'll be paying?
Well, it's a one-time charge, so really this will only affect us moving forward.
Okay.
So this wouldn't affect Chase, who's under construction now, or someone else who's...
Or no. Somebody who's currently there.
No.
Okay.
So we have a couple different choices we can do tonight. We can forward this to council with the proposed changes, or we can ask for some input from Chamber of Commerce and Business Community if we wanted to do that. or have the planning director or economic development director come in and talk about it too. But whatever the committee feels would be best, because I think Paul did a very good job laying it out here. But if we want to notify or ask questions of the business community or anything else before we go ahead and pass this on to council.
I mean, again, it's an improvement over what we had before. So, I mean, if we keep it as is, it's going to be higher charges for a lot of these smaller businesses that are coming in, and a lot more difficult for that.
We don't want that either.
Right, right. I think you really have to look at it. It's going to work out a lot better for a lot of the new businesses. It's going to make it easier for engineering department. It's going to make it easier for planning department to be able to assign these charges for it. I mean, like I said, a lot of times we have fitness clubs coming in. If you look at the old rate.
I remember with Planet Fitness what happened with the rates and everything else. Well, we had a lot of back and forth over those issues.
This eliminates that.
And I'll get you one second, John. And I think that this is a good start to do it, and I just think it really is. And I don't want to have any businesses, you know, be deterred of the current rates. So if we want to go forward with it and then look into it after it's in place and make sure it's the make sure we could have a review in a few months to make sure that it's the comparable with others, with where your operations are and cost of operations or everything else. If we need to tweak something, we can tweak it. I mean, it's really up to the committee. John?
Yeah, the one thing that I forgot to mention to the committee was in these meetings that we would have administratively, Peggy Wild-Dorfman was included in those meetings, and she sat through all of these meetings with us. So I think she would be a good person, if she hasn't already, to convey you know this to the business community, because she not only deals with the existing business community but also new businesses coming in. So I'm sure if she hasn't done it already, she probably has notified the existing business community that we're in the process of doing this, and probably if one assuming that this would move forward and get approved at some point in time, I'm sure she'll spread that word through her communications that she does.
So she was a representative for the business community at the meetings and said, this is what the concerns that we have when we speak to business owners who want to come into the city, who are looking for grants. This is what the issues are. This is some of the holdbacks, and this is why we want to do that.
That's why we had these meetings administratively with my office, with Paul, and with the planning department. I just failed to mention that Peggy was part of that, but so it was a joint effort on several administrative offices, to generate this with the primary goal of making it more inviting for our business community,
more business friendly. That was the main focus.
Okay, yeah, that's I'm happy that occurred. So, is everyone okay going forward with this, or do you want to? Okay. Yeah, I think we're okay. I just wanted to make sure that someone from economic development was at the, and I appreciate you saying that, involved in the process. So it's better than what we have now.
Yeah, I understand your concerns totally. And again, that was the reason why we got together, because, you know, it was creating problems. We were losing businesses to other communities because of the way this was laid out. And I think what you have now is you have something that's a lot more reasonable as far as flow capacities, which is obviously what my concerns were, and I think John can attest to this. I mean, every time we started talking about something, I'm looking at the flows, making sure that they matched up, so we weren't getting shortchanged at the plant.
Well, we know you're doing your job, Paul. So, we just wanted to make sure that someone was involved from the from the business community or that perspective to look into things. That's what I was concerned with. So I'm happy with that.
I wouldn't want it to be part of the legislation, but I would be interested at the end of the year, maybe having Peggy come in and talk about what she is hearing from new businesses as they look at Solon relative to this issue now that you've made these adjustments.
Mm-hmm.
I would be interested in hearing that.
Yeah, that would be good if we could have her come maybe at the December meeting.
Okay. We can arrange that.
Okay.
Okay, thank you, Paul.
It's a difficult one to explain. Like I said, hopefully it makes sense to you. And again, all I can reiterate is that...
The chart helped, Paul.
Is that... You know,
and who
our
programs
thought, what,
the software?
Pardon?
Who programs the software?
Peggy actually started that whole thing, so I can't take credit for that.
Okay.
Okay, is there a motion, Mark?
Sure, in response to Director Solonic's memo to the Public Works Committee regarding sanitary sewer connection fees, I'd like to make a memo to prepare legislation that accepts Exhibit B of his memo to amend the new application and charges for sewer charges levied under codified ordinance section 1046.04E.
Second.
Okay. So moved motion and a second. Proceed to vote. There's no discussion.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes. All right. Thank you, Paul. Thank you, John. Okay, moving on to the next item, we have the 2017 hydrant painting. We have 10 different companies that were sent specifications, and we received back two. Is that normal?
After I communicated this with Akron, who's in the middle of a painting program now, they only had one person respond, and that wasn't one of the ones that we contacted, but they did not give us a quote.
Didn't we used to have, high school kids from the service department doing this?
Yes, we did, and we found out that we didn't really get a quality job out of it, and there was also a lot of damage to our trucks at the end of the year with paint all over them. So it was unsightly, and we were having a lot of issues with that. Plus, they're part-timers, and I don't think they really, not that they weren't good workers, but we had some issues with them, and we'll leave it at that. This is more of an informational memo to the committee. This is kind of a pilot program where I solicited for quotes. I received two quotes back from Old Main Enterprises and Tamaris. Tamaris was the lowest bid at $147 a hydrant, and included in the packet of the specs where they're going to strip the hydrant either via sandblasting or wire wheeling, put a primer coat on, two coats of top coat with our safety yellow, and Chief Shaw requested we put reflective beads in our weather shield, which is at the very top of the hydrant, in case there's something at night and they have the reflectivity of it. Again, it's a pilot program. This is why we went this route, and there's more information, get the committee's consensus on this. And if it is successful, we'll in the future we'll move forward after talking to Mr. Rubino with a full-blown contract.
So before, what we were doing before was just having kids with a bucket of paint and
yes.
a brush go out there and paint it once.
Correct.
This is actually being prepared with the sandblasting and or sanding it, then priming it, then coming back again and doing a top coat, then coming back again and doing a final top coat. So
right.
So we're going to have someone out there four times to each hydrant?
No, they have it broken down. They have a sandblasting crew that goes in front of it. And there's drying times that go along with the primer coat and so they'll be able to knock it out. You know, they have one crew doing the sandblast, another crew following with the painting process.
Okay, so they'll get done in a day or two for.
Well, they should be done by the end of the season with this, with doing the 160 hydrants, and the areas we're concentrating on is Pettibone Road, Rolling Brook. Ridge, Birch, and Cannon Estates. Those are the ones with the most complaints.
The 2 years it's supposed to last?
Yeah, it comes with a two-year warranty.
Okay, and how long do the ones that we had the students
They start peeling within a year.
Okay. And what did we pay approximately for that? Not including the damage to the trucks, but what did we...
They're part-timers, so their wage is anywhere between $10 and $11 an hour.
Okay, and it took them about.
They would maybe do seven hydrants a day. Maybe eight. They'd come there, they'd scrape it off with a little scraper and a wire brush and come back with some paint, and there'd be paint all over the grass, all over the. Yeah, so.
Okay.
We're looking for more of a professional job.
Yeah.
And for a little longer lasting. I anticipate this to last longer than 2 years. Since we're going through the time of stripping, priming, and painting.
Okay, so we just want to try this to see how it works. And
correct.
If it does work, we go further with it. If it doesn't work, we then look to see.
We'll go into other options.
What else we can do.
Correct.
Option C.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you for answering my questions.
Yes, thank you.
Do we need to do anything on this, Bill?
No, no legislation.
So everyone's okay?
We'll need signatures, though.
Okay.
When we get to move forward with the PO.
Mark, you okay with this?
Yes, I am.
Okay. All right, thank you so much. Correspondence, we have none. Other, we have none. Item number 7, Engineering Department Study Design Report. John?
Just a couple things I'll update the committee on. Our Briar Hill Culvert Project, we are in the final design of our project. However, we were initially anticipating on putting a standard culvert in there, but based on some soil information that we got through our geotechnical report, we are looking at needing to put a bridge in there just because of a small bridge because of the soil conditions. So I most likely will be bringing a design amendment to the committee to entertain at next month's meeting. Regarding some other projects, we have several projects under construction. Our concrete repair program, our Roxbury storm sewer replacement program, Copley Road reconstruction, Richmond Road resurfacing, and the Cochran Road Phase 2 reconstruction. Regarding the Samarora intersection, the illuminating company will be delivering poles to the site for the utility pole relocation starting next week, August 7th. I don't anticipate any major work starting next week except for the pole delivery. We have sent notices out to the businesses there in the area, as well as all of the widening and pole relocation work will be done in the northbound lanes of Sama Center, and we have a message board addressing that for all the northbound notices or northbound motorists. It's setting just north of Ports Parkway, notifying the residents as they or the motorists as they drive by. And if there's any other questions the committee may have on any of the items, I can address those now.
Any questions? Move on to the next item, which is the sidewalk program update. Dan, we have your memorandum. How are you this evening?
I'm good, Mr. Chairman.
Quiet
committee.
Back there?
Pardon me?
You've been quiet back there
evening? Oh, yeah. Well, anyway, the sidewalk program, which is done as part of our concrete repair program, is continuing ongoing as the concrete repair program progresses. We were at 5 locations and made approximately $13,233,000 worth of sidewalk repairs in the 4-inch area outside of driveways as needed. We have a remaining balance on that program of $40,134.
Okay, any questions for Mr. Driscoll?
Mm-mm. Thank you, Dan.
Okay, item number 9, we have the annual emergency road repair program update. Dan did a $7,500, 22.69 in emergency work during July. Dan, well, anything on this?
Yes, basically this was to remove concrete caps that were installed during weather when asphalt wasn't available and replace the surface of the pavements with asphalt. So I was cleaning up a lot of areas that had been started previously. We have a $285,910 balance on the emergency road repair program, which at this point appears to be sufficient to get us through the year.
Okay. Any questions for Dan?
Thank you.
Item number 10, Mike and the ultimate level of efficiency already covered his report. So are there any questions for Mike? Or do you have anything else you want to...
No, apparently I should have waited, so...
No, what we can we can, in the future, since that went so well, we could put that up with your item.
Yeah,
we can do it. Why don't we just do both of those at once? If the clerk, we can just put that with his item in the future. See, this is how we do things.
This is how government works. I'm a trendsetter. Who knew?
Exactly. So we will move Mike's item number 10 from now on into his update for the next agenda, so... We'll take care of it from there. Thank you, Mike.
No problem.
All right. We'll move on to the Water Reclamation Department. Paul?
Just an update on the construction project. We finally broke ground. All the permits have been pulled for at least contract A. They actually started clearing the site yesterday, and it's completely cleared as of today. It's amazing how fast that these guys can come in and clear 4 acres of property. Mm-hmm. Contract B is still in the process of getting the contract documents together, so we are still working on that, but I don't foresee that that should be much longer than a week. I hope to have that at least to be able to bring by the next meeting for sure. If not, a special meeting if I can. When that comes in, I will try to contact you and maybe see if we can get a special Public Works meeting scheduled if I do get that in.
If you do get that, if you want to let Patty know or let us know and send us all an email, and then our Patty can get a hold of us and we can see if we can schedule a special meeting before a council meeting so we can get that moved along.
Okay.
Any questions for Paul? We have the Service Department report. Bill?
A couple things. Like to thank our electricians for home days. They did a great job making sure everything was all set up, and if there was any issues, they resolved them quickly. You know, it takes a whole week for them to set that up, and it's a lot of work involved, so I want to thank Timmy and Kevin for taking care of that. A couple other things I'd like to bring to the committee's attention. We received the salt contract bids back. And for Cuyahoga County, salt will be paying $29.12 a ton, which is down from $29.23 a ton from last year. So see a little savings there. And
what
also,
what were those numbers, Bill?
Salt came in at $29.12 a ton.
Okay.
This year for Cuyahoga County, and that's a reduction from last year's prices were $29.23. And I believe Cargill was the awarded bidder off the state contract. Simple Recycling, I sent the memo to the committee about them changing their color of their bags, so they should be sending, if they haven't received already, the new bags and the new information. And as they can still use their green bags to put their Simple Recycling out, but as they use their green bags, they'll be replaced with the orange bags.
Are they sending those to everyone or just people who are, you know, real regular participants?
I believe they were just sending them to everybody just to make sure they had the updated bags. And then a couple weeks ago, we worked some brush overtime to catch everything up on the brush. Guys did a great job. And so we're making it through the city a little bit quicker now. We're down to 5-day rotation. As long as we don't get to see some big piles or some big windstorms, we should be in good shape. And again, I did change the report a little bit for the committee, so if there's something different they want to see or if they like what they see, they could just let me know.
Okay. Any questions for Bill? Okay. Before we adjourn, just want to thank everyone for participation during home days and the booths. And I know a lot of people did go to the Public Works booths. That this committee, you know, works with on a regular basis, and it really, really was nice to have everyone there. So, anything else? Okay. Is there a motion to adjourn?
Good meeting.
What's that?
So it was a good meeting.
Yeah,
motion to adjourn.
I so move that we adjourn.
Second.
Okay. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mr. Polonis?
Yes.